That's actually the question that I was asked by a store clerk just a couple weeks ago as I was checking out. And I exuberantly said, "Why, yes, I am. I love Christmas and what it is that we celebrate." And she goes, "Oh, you have your shopping done?" You see, her question, "Are you ready for Christmas?" really meant, "Do you have your Christmas shopping done? If you've got your presents all purchased and wrapped, then everything's good. And if you don't have the presents purchased and wrapped, then you're not ready." And I thought, okay, I guess that's indicative of our day and our age and our culture. But it sure misses the point, doesn't it? So I want to ask you the question, are you ready for Christmas? Luke chapter 2, verses 21 through 38. It's a story that actually Nick preached several months ago, and I gave him the entirety of chapter 2. And so I'm going to go back and just refresh your memory on a portion of that. It's a story of two elderly individuals that encounter the Christ child shortly after his birth. Simeon and Anna are their names. I want to read the text today in three sections and stop and pause at the end of that each section and share a few thoughts with you. Chapter 2, Gospel of Luke, beginning at verse 21. "And when 8 days had passed before his circumcision, his name was then called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And when the days for their purification, according to the law of Moses, were completed, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male that opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what was said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons." You know, that may sound quite odd to us. It's not our religious tradition and practice. It was a Jewish religious practice and ritual. But there's actually two occasions and three rituals that are spoken of in these two paragraphs. And I'm not going to go into great depth of them. I just want to tell you what they are so that we kind of get the setting for what unfolds in the encounter with Simeon and Anna. The first occasion is on Jesus' 8th day of life. Circumcision of a Hebrew male child always took place on the 8th day. It was so important that it take place on the 8th day that it could even be performed on the Sabbath. It's one of those works that the people were allowed to engage in on that holy day. And the day of circumcision is also the day of naming. And so his name is given, and his name is Jesus. The name that Luke reminds us that had been given to him even before his conception. "You shall have a son, and you shall call his name Jesus." And I know that we've covered this just about every December that I've been here, but let's refresh our memories. Jesus means he saves. God is my salvation. He saves. What an appropriate name for this Christ child. What an appropriate name for this little boy who is the Savior of the world. The second occasion that we have is on Jesus' 40th day. The book of Exodus has a number of laws. The book of Leviticus has a number of laws. The book of Deuteronomy has a number of laws. And there are two things that unfold here. First is the dedication of the firstborn. You can read about it in Exodus 13. It's rooted in the Exodus and how God had delivered finally the people of Israel with the 10th plague. And the 10th plague was the death of the firstborn of all of the Egyptian people. And for Israel, the birth of a male child who was your first child, that child is to be set apart and holy to the Lord. But he could be redeemed. He could be bought back by the parents, if you were. Basically, this child belongs to God, which in some ways all of us do. But the parents would then go to the temple and offer sacrifice. The sacrifice was a lamb and a pigeon. But for some families, that was way too much. It's just too expensive. And so provision had been made, and it was called the offering of the poor. And that's what we read here. Two pigeons or two turtle doves. And that's what Mary and Joseph brought, for they were poor. And in giving that, it gives us a picture yet once again into that early childhood of Jesus. Not born into opulence, not born into royalty. The King of Kings simply came, born there in Bethlehem, redeemed here in Jerusalem, raised in Nazareth, the son of a carpenter. The third thing that has to happen also takes place the same time as the dedication of Jesus on this 40th day, and that's the purification of the mother. Mary would come and would offer sacrifice. Scripture tells us that life is in the blood. And so a sacrifice of an animal was a blood sacrifice. The sacrifice of Jesus will be a blood sacrifice. We just participated in the Lord's Supper. And I know it sounds odd, maybe even strange to ears that have not grown up with the understanding that Scripture gives us. But this bread is my body. This cup, this wine is my blood, which takes us back to Calvary. It takes us back to the cross upon which He bled and died. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Blood is life. Now, I have six kids, and I know that birth involves blood. It just does. And so in the Hebrew faith practice, Mary would have been ceremonially unclean, not because she had committed a sin, not because she had done anything wrong, simply because blood, which is life, which is a beautiful picture in it, because in the bringing forth of life, the baby, there is blood, which is life, which represents sacrifice and being. And so on 40 days, she would come and offer sacrifice, and she would be cleansed and welcomed back into the religious services. So that's what's going on here. At 8 days, Jesus is sacrificed and named. At 40 days, Mary offers her personal sacrifice, and Jesus is redeemed. Jesus is bought back. He's dedicated, if you will, at the temple in Jerusalem. And while there, they encounter two old people. I know the picture's hard to see, but the picture represents Joseph and Mary to the right, Simeon in the middle holding the Christ child, and Anna to the left. Let's read first of all about Simeon. This picks up at verse 25 of Luke 2. And there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was righteous and devout, looking for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to carry out for him the custom of the law, then he took him into his arms and blessed God and said, "Now, Lord, you are releasing your bondservant to depart in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light of revelation to the Gentiles, and the glory of your people Israel." And his father and mother were amazed at the things which were being said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "Behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rise of many in Israel, and for a sign to be opposed, and a sword will pierce even your own soul, to the end that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed." What an interesting picture. What an interesting story. One of the things that I enjoy doing is hearing that a young couple has given birth and rushing up to the hospital to be one of the first folks who get a visit. You know, I like to pray for the wife and the husband and the baby. I like to bless them and just be there to celebrate with them. I love those kind of times. Can you imagine being Mary and Joseph in this moment? And this old man takes your baby and starts spouting the words that we just read. No wonder the text tells us that Joseph and Mary were amazed. Time and again, we read about Mary pondering things in her heart. Mothers do that, you know. There are things of those of you who are moms remember from every stage of your children's lives. Moms just ponder things in their heart. And the scriptures tell us Mary did that. And Joseph and Mary here are amazed. They knew what the angel had told them. They knew that this child was unique. But at every corner, at every turn, they seemed to learn a little bit more. Let's look at this just a bit. What an interesting fellow this Simeon is. He's righteous and devout. Righteous, his character is godly. This is a man whose life is rooted in his faith, and his faith is lived. Not mere words that he speaks, not mere actions or rituals that he performs as duty, but a real life of walking with Christ, with God, in anticipation of Christ. And he's devout. Devotion. Sold out to. We need a good dose of devotion in our lives today. People who commit and stay committed, that's the idea. People who pour into and are not easily distracted from that which is eternal, that which is important. Simeon is a man who is righteous and devout. And he's looking. He's waiting for, he's anticipating the consolation of Israel. This is interesting. The word consolation here is paraklesis. It's related to parakletos, which is the word that Jesus uses when he's in the upper room and tells the apostles, it's good for you if I go, because if I go, I will send to you another counselor, another comforter, which is the Holy Spirit. Jesus is the original paraklesis. He is the one who comes and walks with his people. John in his gospel says the word became flesh and dwelt for a while among us, literally saying pitched his tent with us. Simeon was awaiting that. If life is to be lived well, it will be lived well in relationship to, in fellowship with, the very present God. Pretty cool. Very important. That's what he's anticipating. That's what he's waiting for. And the Holy Spirit, in one way or another, we're not told how, has communicated to him, has revealed to him that he's not going to die until he has seen the Christ child. When he's finally seen the Lord's Christ, then he can depart in peace. Can you imagine having that to look forward to? The hope of Israel. A hope was voiced from God first to Adam and Eve in the garden. A hope that had been voiced last by Malachi 400 years before this. That Christ would come, that a Savior would come, that a Deliverer would come. And Simeon has been waiting just like everyone else in Israel, but it's been revealed to him, you're going to get to see him. Your eyes are going to be able to set on him and have a vision of him. And he comes into the temple. Mary and Joseph are there. Jesus is now 40 days old. And I don't know how he knows, but Simeon knows this is the child. Somehow the Holy Spirit makes it clear, this is the one. And he comes and he takes the baby in his arms. And what does he do? He blesses God. We use the word bless in so many ways. We think of how we're blessed, and we think maybe of good things that God has poured into our lives. The word bless literally means to speak well of. That's what it means. To bless means to speak words to someone which are truthful and which are encouraging, and to speak well of them. You know? We need more blessing in our world today. And Simeon blesses God. When he sees the promised Christ of God, takes him in his hands, as in this picture, what comes from him is a song of praise, is a prayer of blessing. Verse 30 again, "For my eyes have seen your salvation." That's what it's all about. "This which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples." Remember, he's waiting for the consolation of Israel. But this child is not just for one people group. This child is not just for one nationality. He is a light of revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people, Israel. I'm glad for that, aren't you? I'm a Gentile by nationality. And yet this hope is my hope. And this hope is yours. Man, are you ready for Christmas? I'll tell you, it's not about turkey and ham. It's not about presents. In our house, we have roast beef sandwiches and we have cinnamon rolls. And we read Luke 2. And Luke 2 is what it's about. Are you ready for Christmas? Simeon was. Simeon had been waiting his whole life for Christmas. And when Christmas came, because Christmas is not a date on a calendar, Christmas is the Lord's Christ. When Jesus came, blessing, blessing unto God. And then notice what happens. There's a prophecy. Not only does he bless God, but Simeon turns to Joseph and Mary, who are just standing there amazed. I mean, they're absolutely overwhelmed. You know, a part of me thinks, you know, proud parents. Yeah, that's our boy. Yeah. And a part of me's thinking, they're going, "You got to be kidding, really? Yeah, we knew something was special about this from what the angel said, you know, but this is getting, we're in way over our heads, aren't we?" And Simeon turns to them and he blesses them. He speaks encouraging words to them and the role that they fill as father and mother to this blessed child of God. And he says, this child has been appointed. This child has a role to fill. This child is going to be the cause of the fall of many in Israel. Well, all of a sudden, this just took a sad turn, didn't it? There are going to be many who, when they encounter this child, do not embrace him with blessing unto God, but they oppose him with animosity for who he is and what he stands for and what he brings. They will not appreciate his identifying himself as the Son of God. They will not appreciate his call to a life that is holier than what they had been taught. They will not understand the death and the resurrection, and they will fall. But the other side of that coin is he's appointed to bring about what? The rise of many in Israel, the lifting up, the bringing out of the slimy pit of sin, the bringing out of the poverty of life, the bringing out of hopelessness and helplessness. This child is going to lift people up. Man, again, our world needs lifting up. Our world needs hope. And he's going to be assigned to be opposed. I can't imagine how it is, but there are those who will oppose hope. And that opposition will bring him to the point of sacrifice. We're back to blood again. And Simeon says to Mary, a sword will pierce even your own soul. It's beyond our comprehension, is it not? But to picture Mary at the foot of the cross, her son nailed to it, his blood flowing forth, his body having been flogged, having been beaten to a point almost beyond recognition. The pain and the anguish in a mother's heart. But what will ultimately result, Simeon says, is that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed. In the falling, in the rising, in the opposing, in the piercing of your own heart, we will see those who embrace God through his Son and those who reject God because of his Son. What do you think of God? It's revealed in what you think of and how you respond to Jesus. Jesus seems to become just a name for so many people. A name to be used as a swear word for so many others. A name that might just be, who knows, the Washington Post in its typical December rant against Christmas denied a historical Jesus. Jesus is a nice myth from 2,000 years ago. There are those who will fall. But there are those, and I see it in our children. I don't know if you can tell, but their names are here so that they knew where to stand. Right now, I'm Gage. Right now, I'm Gage. See, I got my cheat sheet. It's okay. I look at these kids, and I listen to them sing. And all of life is out there in front of them, and some of it's going to be difficult, isn't it? Oh, if only they knew. Prepare them well, moms and dads. Give them hope. Point them to Jesus. Because when life stinks, they'll be able to be lifted up if they embrace the child of Bethlehem. Hope does not have to be lost. Hope is rooted in a person. It's rooted in Jesus. Well, I have to go on. There's just a paragraph. We don't have a whole lot of detail in this last paragraph, but we meet one more character. We meet Anna. Beginning at verse 36 of Luke chapter 2, there was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years and had lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, and then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, serving night and day with fastings and prayers. At that very moment, she came up and began giving thanks to God and continued to speak of him to all those who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. A prophetess, a woman who speaks the words of God, who speaks to people for God. That's a little bit challenging to us. Not the content of today's message. It's just interesting to see how she's identified. And her name is Anna. She had been married 7 years. Don't know how early she got married. In that culture, often mid to late teens, were married. So probably by the time she's 25 or so, she's a widow. Her husband has died. Maybe of disease, maybe in an accident, maybe in an armed conflict. We don't know. And she had then lived until the age now of 84. 84. She was not bitter. She was not disappointed. She did not look back upon her days and grieve. What we find in Anna is a woman whose heart is filled with hope. She has spent her days serving in the temple through fasting and prayer. Worship has been the watermark, the characteristic of this woman's activity. And at that very moment, that what moment? This moment when Simeon is speaking to Mary and Joseph, holding the Christ child, blessing God, she comes up and she simply joins in by giving thanks to God. She recognizes the child as well. She understands the truth of Simeon's words, and her heart opens up with thanksgiving. So grateful. So thankful. And she just continued to speak about him to everyone who was looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. Remember, Simeon was waiting for the consolation of Israel. And she speaks to those looking for the redemption of Israel, the saving. It's the same story, different words. Anna was ready for Christmas. 84 years old and still excited about what was to come. She was ready for Christmas. Simeon was waiting. Sometimes we need to learn to wait upon the Lord. We're in a hurry. We rush. We think that if we're not absolutely exhausted by our use of time, that we've wasted time. Simeon was waiting. Oh, how we would do well to learn to sit and to be still, to wait and to listen for God. I fear that sometimes we don't hear him because, well, if he was shouting, we wouldn't hear him because we're too busy. Anna was serving. Anna had found her place in the temple and was giving her life to minister to others. She was a giving type of gal. Maybe we need to learn what it is to serve with a humble heart, with faithful expectation, with love for others as we wait for God to redeem his people. For we wait too, do we not? Christmas comes. Jesus arrives. We know the story. He will teach and instruct. He'll touch lives. He'll do miracles. He'll heal the sick. He'll raise the dead. He'll open the eyes of the blind. He'll be crucified. He'll conquer death and rise from the grave. He will ascend to the right hand of God and send his Spirit to dwell within his people, the church. And so we have lived for 2,000 years. But he will come again. And so we wait in eager expectation of what we call the second coming. Or what, just for this morning's purpose, I want to call the second Christmas. And while we wait, we serve. We get to be like Simeon and Anna. I know, and I speak this with serious understanding, I think. I know that for some people, the holidays, quote unquote, are difficult. Maybe a loved one is absent. Maybe it's the time of a marking of a death. I don't know if you noticed our Facebook pages. Gretchen and I and Mana have a friend that we went to college with who died this week. Don Gibbs from Milwaukee. He didn't show up for Bible study. His son went to check on him. And he had died, presumably of a heart attack. This Christmas will be very hard for Josh and Katie, his two kids. Dad's gone. couple weeks ago, good friends of ours, Jerry and Kathy Hayward, ministers, minister and his wife in Pennsylvania, were hit head on by a guy who lost control of his car, killed them both. Their kids and grandkids are going to have kind of a rough Christmas because mom and dad and grandma and grandpa are gone. I know that sometimes the holidays are hard, but Jerry and Kathy's family and Don's family, my family and your families understand something. Christmas is about hope. Christmas is about Jesus' birth, not just a baby in a manger, but the Son of God come to redeem. He is Israel's consolation. He is Jerusalem's redemption. And we bless God and thank Him for what He's given us. Joy to the world. The Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. I want us to leave this morning walking on cloud nine, as they say. I want us to leave today with joy welling up in our hearts so it just can't be compressed or suppressed, that it just kind of comes spewing out. I want us to, this week, be the people in Cedar Rapids that when people engage us, they go, those people are weird. Some of you don't have to work on that, Dennis. I want people to say, what is it? And you can tell them that it is the joy of the Lord, which is rooted in the hope of the nations, that Christ is born. Amen? Amen. I'm going to ask Nick and our worship leaders to come forward. I simply have one last question I'll ask you. Are you ready for Christmas? Yes. Amen. Thank you, Linda. Are you ready for Christmas? Not for presents, but for the child. For the child who is life, the child who brings life. For Jesus. Jesus, the one who is our salvation. Would you stand as we sing?